If we could open our Bibles, please, to John chapter 13. Thank you, John. Chapter 13. I'm reading from verse 34. A new command I give you. Love one another. I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this all men will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. I think we can pause there. Well-known words often quoted. But sometimes that which is often quoted and well known, the full import of it may not be written within our spirits. And the words that Yeshua spoke to his disciples and to those who were his hearers were words to live by, not merely words just to remember as nice sounding phrases. But his words and his teachings would have the ability to revolutionize the lives of his hearers, those who sought to follow him in what it says. He would turn their world upside down, even in the simplest, so-called simplest of truths. Sometimes we become so familiar with the written word that we no longer think about it. We no longer focus on what Yeshua says or what he means. All we hear is words coming like a sound into our ears and it's lost in the wind. But Yeshua spoke significant words that had a great impact upon his hearers then, and I believe that should have a similar impact upon us today. He says, a new commandment I give you. And the next thing he begins to talk about is love. First thing that comes to my mind was, well, love per se was not a new commandment. For the simple reason that it is written in Leviticus 19, verse 18, thou shalt not avenge, nor bear any grudge against the children of thy people, but thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. I am Yahweh. So then, if Yeshua said, a new commandment I give you, clearly, the new commandment was not just about love per se, because that commandment had been around for thousands of years. In fact, it says in the Torah, thou shalt love Yahweh with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy strength, with all thy might, and thy neighbor as thyself. So what's new? He said a new commandment. There must be something new. Was it just love, as we would understand love today? Let me say that first there was a change to the quality of the love. In the Torah, Yahweh taught his people, as they prepared to enter into Canaan, into the land that he had promised them, he says, listen, when you cross over, you're going to see seven nations more powerful and more mighty than you. I want you to destroy these nations. Hello? He says, I want you to destroy them. The Amalekites, the Amorites, the Hittites, the Jebusites, the Hivites, the Hittites, the Canaanites. Destroy them! He says, you shall not have pity on them. Hold on there. Is this the same Yahweh speaking here? It says, when you get into the land, remove them, exterminate your eyes. Then you will continually be having issues with these people if you don't remove them completely. So when you get into the land, make sure you make a complete removal of all those who occupy the land. Those who are far off, the far off nations, you can offer them peace. You can live in peace, and if they want to be your servants, that's fine. But those that are in the land, the Canaanites and their different clans, they are to be destroyed. Now somebody on the outside looking at this would say, but why? Yahweh, this is unreasonable. I thought Yahweh is love. How can a being who says he is love give orders for the annihilation of certain classes and types of people? It's not making sense. Let me say to you that we ought not to judge the times that those people lived in by the same measure in which we measure our existence and our times and our relationship today. Those people lived in different times and in different circumstances, and the commands that Yahweh gave them was for their own good and for their own benefit. And the full story is not just told when we say, Yahweh said, just exterminate them. He didn't just randomly choose people to exterminate and kill. He said in one scripture that the iniquity of the Amorites was not yet full. In other words, he had been giving these nations chance after chance for centuries. And there came a time when their cup of iniquity was so full that the only thing left was judgment. There were past repentance, past changing, only judgment, and Israel was to be the sword in Yahweh's hand that was to bring judgment upon those nations. That's the context of it. He was building a people unto himself, a peculiar people who would impact the world, and it was important that as they built up and as they were established as a nation, there would be no hindrance, there would be no corruption amongst them, and they would arise and be the shining light that he wanted them to be. Yes. Fortunately, we know that they failed because they did not carry out Yahweh's command in detail. But time and time again, we hear them sparing some of the people. Classical story was the one of Saul. Remember Saul when he was sent to destroy the Amalekites? What did he do? He saved the best of the cattle and the sheep to offer sacrifices unto Yahweh, so he said. But he also spared the king, Agag. No wonder why he would spare Agag. Perhaps he wanted to boast and show off Agag as a trophy of his victory. Here I have a prisoner of war, see what I can do. But what does Samuel do? Samuel says, where's Agag? Samuel comes up to see him. Agag, the Bible says, came delicately, walking like a king, because he said, surely the bitterness of death is past. Samuel said to him, in the same way your sword has made women childless, I'm going to make your mother childless today. And the Bible says in the King James Version, it says he hewed him in pieces. Other versions are more mild. They say he killed him. But the King James Version said he chopped him up fine. We would say, Samuel, the prophet, the anointed prophet of Yahweh, being used in such a way, not merely to kill a man, but to really hack him to death? Yes. I say again, we cannot measure the commands of those times by the covenants of today. Yahweh was dealing, fulfilling a purpose then, and he's fulfilling a purpose today. So when Yeshua says, a new commandment I give unto you, in one other place he said to them, it is written, you shall love your neighbor, but hate your enemies. I say to you, love your enemies as you love yourself. Do good to those who despitefully use you. Hallelujah. The subject then of love is very important, especially in the light of Yeshua saying, it's by this that men will know that you're my disciples. First of all, love has been redefined in our society. And when somebody now speaks about love, you have to listen very carefully to what they're saying and try to discern what they possibly mean. Because the word love is a wide word. Some people love them dog. Is that the same love that you have for a child? Answer me now. Is it the same love? Tell you something, there's some people who love their animals more than they love people. They cry tears if a cow bumps the animal. And if they hear that a child is starving elsewhere, they switch the channel off and go somewhere else. That doesn't interest them. Some will spend thousands of hard-earned dollars in giving the best medical care possible to a pig. I said to a pig. You know, so they are pet pigs. They will take their dog to the dentist. Yes, to get the plaque off his teeth. They will make sure he gets all his immunization shots. I have seen dogs dressed up better than people in a winter coat with their head held high, full of pride. Not like common dogs. Dressed and their hair combed and shampooed, looking good. People say they love their animals. No, there's nothing wrong with loving your animals, you know. In fact, the Bible teaches us that we should not be cruel. But there is a place where animals must be kept. As far as I'm concerned, even in the heart, I believe, as the heart of man, I believe that we ought to care for our animals. But sometimes there is a kind of excess that people go to. When you speak of love, then what do you mean? The Greeks used different words to express love. They used like the word philia, which described the love that a man may have for his brother, a kind of family affection that is amongst, a common love that is amongst relatives. There is another word for the love that exists between a man and a woman, or a man and his wife, a different kind of a love. Then there is another word, eros, from which you get the term erotic, from which it describes sexual type of love, which is another word, another class of love, which is much held in confusion today. Then there is the agape, which is that unselfish kind of love that Yahweh displays, that he so loved that he gave. It's not an emotional thing. It's not to do with feeling, though feelings may be affected. It's a love that he chooses to love. He doesn't love because persons qualify for love, or they are in a certain bracket, therefore deserving love. He simply loves. He chooses to love. In fact, Yahweh taught Israel and said, listen, you must not think that Yahweh loves you because you are more numerous or that you are better. No, you are not more numerous. You are better than anybody else. If Yahweh, in his sovereign choice, chooses to love you, the love him. The New Testament we read. We love him. Why? Because he first loved us. It wasn't because we were all lovers of Yahweh while Yahweh said, people love me, so I will love them back. No. We hated him, in fact, because we loved the deeds of darkness. But while we were yet sinners, the Messiah died for us, the just for the unjust, to bring us to Yahweh. So the love of which we speak, which Yeshua speaks, we must look at its quality. We must look at the type of love, because it's important that we exhibit the same kind of love, and unless we understand it and know it, how can we exhibit it? Because we might be thinking, this love of which Yeshua speaks is the one that we practice, and it may be something a little inferior to that. Hallelujah. A new commandment I give you. What kind of love did Yeshua have? We could put it down just to use two words. It was a sacrificial love, and it was also an enduring love. What do I mean by sacrificial? In laying down his life, paying the ultimate price that anyone can pay to demonstrate his love, that is the kind of love that Yeshua had for us. Greater love hath no man than this, than that a man lay down his life for his friend. In other words, Yeshua is saying, this is the standard by which we measure love. And not only that, this is the kind of love I want you to have. Love that's willing to lay down our lives for our friends. Whoa. If I was to say today, put up your hand, all those who have this love. I find that I don't have any too many friends. This love, then, must be of a different and a higher order than ordinary human love. Yeshua saw writing about giving your body to be burned, yet lacking love. In other words, people can do wondrous, heroic, great and mighty deeds and still don't have love. Hallelujah. His love, in fact, he said, he could in no wise help himself. He could in no wise help himself. Such was the quality and the depth of his love that it led to the ultimate sacrifice that any man can make for another. So then, if this is the ultimate love, what about people who so love a cause that they will strap explosives to their body and they will go into a crowd, a restaurant, a bus, a marketplace, a hospital, even a school, care not, and will trigger that explosion and blow themselves up for a cause, for a purpose? Are those hearts filled with love for the being that they say they worship? Is it love that motivates them? Tell me, is it love that they're willing to lay down their lives? Let me tell you the big secret. It's not love, you know. It is love in a way. It's love for themselves. Self-love that somebody has told them. that if they do this sort of thing, the reward that is ahead of them will be marvelous. They are going straight into paradise. Seven virgins await them to minister to their every need. And their hearts and minds are filled with beautiful thoughts of paradise and paramount seven virgins and other delights that they enjoy upon earth, because they think paradise is like earth but better without the restrictions. Is that love? No. Yeshua's love was not merely because of the reward, but there was a reward. His love is an enduring love. He says, having loved his own, he loved them unto the end. That means to the end of his life, no matter what they said, he kept on loving them. He didn't stop loving them. When Peter betrayed, forsook him, and denied him, he still loved him. Yes. And you know he loved Judas too.
Oh, yes.
Judas betrayed him. He never jumped up and railed. He says, Judas betrays thou the Son of Man with a kiss. Mm-hmm. You can hear the inquiring heart. There was no bitterness and rage. As if to say, Judas, how could you do such a thing when I've only done you good? Love was in his heart. He loved them to the very end. That is why today we can have confidence. That is why today we are assured of his love, because he is risen from the dead and his love is still toward us even now. And it's still an enduring love. In fact, I want to say that love is the gold standard by which our discipleship is measured. What do I mean by gold standard? Well, we often speak of gold standard in this world. And the phrase simply means it's a thing of superior quality. It serves as a point of reference against which all other things of its type can be compared. In other words, Yeshua's love, or the love of Yahweh manifested through Yeshua, is the gold standard. Every other type of love must be measured up against that. And if it doesn't match up, it's something lower, lesser, and inferior. And it is this kind of love that he requires and demands of his disciples.
Oh, yes.
We live in a world where currency is continually being devalued. The dollar, one Jamaican dollar, isn't worth a great deal. Isn't that so? And in other countries, £1 will be 160 or 70 times just £1. So, because you have a dollar, you may say, I am rich. I have $10,000. I am rich. But what is the standard by which you are measuring the value of those dollars? Because if you take your $10,000 and you fly overseas, you will just, you barely get just over £120 for it. So your 10,000 isn't all that valuable. Hallelujah. And it's the same with love. We can all talk about love, but what is the gold standard? How is it measured? Is it just love, 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 love? For all I know, the love of which you're speaking might be worth as much as a Jamaican dollar. You will note that in the Torah, when Yahweh was teaching his people about bringing sacrifices and gifts to the temple, and the value of things, this phrase, the shekel of the sanctuary, kept coming up. In other words, if you're exchanging money, if you're buying goods, if you're doing any kind of commerce where the temple was concerned, the shekel of the sanctuary was the standard by which you had to work to. You couldn't just bring a shekel and say, this is a shekel. It had to weigh the same, because remember, those money had to be weighed. It had to weigh the same as the shekel of the sanctuary, because the shekel was money that weighed something. People used to weigh their money, and your shekel may be light. Your shekel may be heavy. Your shekel may be of an inferior quality. It may not have the necessary amount of gold or silver in it. So in fact, you had to have a standard by which it could be valued, and it could be weighed, and it was the shekel of the sanctuary. Hallelujah. So our love must be to the gold standard that Yeshua said. He says, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples. By loving one another, all men know you're my disciples. But what are many? There are many groups in the world, not only religious groups. There are many fraternities, brotherhoods, organizations, in which the adherents and those who are part of that group show love, respect, and concern to other members of the same fraternity. You understand what I'm saying? You may not necessarily belong to a church, but you may belong to some group and some organization, some caring organization. And the members in that organization can have respect and love for one another. Is then this the standard of love of which Yeshua is speaking about? We need to look at the term love and see if we can draw from it, see if we can extract from it some of what is in Yahweh's heart. You see, love is not just friendship, though friendship is included. I can be good friends with you, all of you sitting here. Does that mean then that I'm manifesting the love of which Yeshua speaks? I certainly must be friends with you. But love is more than friendship. There is even different qualities of friendship. The Proverbs or the scripture says, there is a love, or there is a friend, that sticketh closer than a brother. In other words, you can have a friend who loves you more than your own brother love you.
Yes.
In fact, in many families that are fractured, where there is deep divisions, a lot of times people will go outside that family to seek solace, to seek love, and to seek friendship. The love that they're supposed to find in the family circle is not there, and they seek it elsewhere. That is the story of many a person who has fallen into sin, or who has mixed up with bad company. They were seeking love, and they never found it at home, so they went elsewhere for it. Love is more, though, than just friendship. It is more than just affection, though affection must be a part of love. Love is more than sharing, though sharing must be a part of love. Hallelujah. Love has to be stronger and greater. How many times you have listened to the news? Shooting has taken place in a certain community. People have come on the road to voice their anger, displeasure, and protest. Maybe a mother, a sister, an auntie comes up. Person who was shot may have been a reputed bad man, gunman, thief, robber. Could be. And you will hear his mother speaks for him. He was such a loving boy. Never give any trouble. I don't know which boy in the world never give trouble. But this one, never give any trouble. A good family man. Take care of his children well. Hard working. And if when you hear the testimonial of this lady, you think in your mind, well, he's wicked. Wicked. Oh, they could rid the world of such a wonderful citizen. Some wrong something. They are wicked such a people. And after they are, everything died down. Everything died down and the quietness come and the story bits begin to filter. You say, my man, prison record long so. Here said they didn't lock him up for real. And he was in prison for manslaughter or murder. And that secret, and that secretly, way for people in the community, glad him dead. But they couldn't say so because TV jaded a shining camera in their face. So they couldn't say so. So they have to speak well. Let me say that a mother's love, probably besides the love of Yahweh and Yeshua, probably the mother's love is probably next in line. Because a mother will overlook every wickedness, every badness in their child and love them still. Isn't that so? Of course they are in these days that which the scripture speaks and prophesies that will happen. That those will be born without natural affection. But where there is natural affection, I think amongst humans, the love of a mother is higher and probably greater than even the love of a man for his wife. Because there is no reward after the mother is getting. Sometimes she's pure sacrifice. Pure sacrifice. Tears, work, and sometimes no reward whatsoever, but still she loves. Whereas, man and wife, after a while, they can say, listen, you've gone your ways, we've gone mine. Time for a change. The mother's love, then, is comparable to the father's. But how many mothers will lay down their lives for their children? There are some. There are some who will do it. There are many who will do it. Many who will do it. But usually it's a good boy. Not a bad boy. A real good boy, because in her heart of hearts she knows the truth. And if it's a real good boy, she'll take a risk to lay down her life. But if it's a bad boy, if she's young, she'll probably take the another one. I don't know what that one. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples. are my disciples, because you speak with tongues. He did not say you are my disciples because you prophesy. You are not my disciples simply because you can exhort one another, or even testify, or because you sing about love. You're not my disciples because you pray much, or preach much, or even give. For you can do all of that and still not have love. Hallelujah. So the necessity of this love as the hallmark and the gold standard by which disciples can be measured and judged, we must ask ourselves the question, am I loving as I should? Am I manifesting the love of Yahweh as I should? Or am I just talking about it? Singing about it? Professing to have it? Or is this love really in my heart? This is something we must answer individually. How far will our love go? He commands them to love. He does not give them as an option to say, try and love one another. No. This command I give you, a new command I give you, that you love one another. And like I said, love has always been a requirement. But now he's putting to it a command, a new command. He's putting into force something is of a higher quality, something that is richer, deeper, more excellent. That we have to ask ourselves, show me this love. Teach me about this love. The love of which he speaks, the command to love, is not the kind of love that is looking around at everybody else and judging others and saying, so and so, no have no love. No. If you are looking around and judging others and saying so and so don't have no love, then you are demonstrating you don't have any either. Because love does not make that kind of a determination about people who we don't know too much about. Love isn't going around engaging in measuring the standard of other people's love. It goes around instead in engaging, in showing love, in spite of the shortcomings and failures of others. Do you understand what I'm saying? The love of which Yeshua is speaking about is not merely the sentimental hugging and kissing business, or merely sentimental affection. It is also manifested in discipline, in holiness. It is also manifested in rebuke and in suffering.
Oh, now what have these got to do with love?
Discipline.
Love and discipline. You may think they are poles apart.
But love and, but one of the ingredients of love is discipline. You can profess all you want how much you love your child. But sooner or later, they have to be disciplined.
Yes.
Because out of that love is a concern for their future, for their well-being. And sometimes, you have to shut your ears to their crying and administer some loving rebuke, which I will not spell out right now, but some kind of loving rebuke, some kind of a chastisement, something that will demonstrate in the long run that you love them, not in the short run. Because usually at times like that, they go away in years and years and years. So love me. But ultimately, the scripture says, discipline brings forth fruit. Fruit of righteousness. It says, even Yahweh, who we cannot question his love, we cannot doubt his love, there are times when he must discipline us. And if he did not discipline us, the scripture says, then he's not treating you like children, but rather he's treating you like bastards or illegitimate children. So love and discipline has to come together. And when we talk about love, we must not be only engaged in a sentimentality kind of a feeling. And say, I feel the love in my heart. Suppose you don't feel any love in your heart, you stop loving. Hello, I'm talking to you. If you don't feel any love, have you stopped loving? Sorry for me. If you only tell your love me, it's because you feel the love coming. Suppose you don't feel any love.
Is the love still there?
Love is not merely a feeling. The love of Yahweh is a choice. He chooses to love us. When love is a feeling, I look over the people and I make a determination as to who I am going to love. I love that one there because I want to look pretty. I love that one day because that one day is in a good bracket and have a good job. I love that one day because he treats me with respect. Yes. I love that one day because she I'm comfortable when I'm around her. I don't love that one day though. Because face is always set up hard. Don't love that one because I don't love your family. Just because your family, I don't like where you come from. I don't love that one there because you're too soft, you're too fool, you're too this, you're too that. Is that what love is about? In our immaturity, in our developmental stages, we do love particular persons, but as we grow in love, for the Bible tells us we must grow in love, so the scope and the breadth of those with whom we can embrace in love must also grow. So a new believer will tend to latch to one or two persons for development. That's important. But as time goes on, they find out now that other persons have other things to offer also, and their love will increase and be widened more and more. Hallelujah. The love of which we speak is the love that puts service above self.
Yes.
It's one of the mottos we have in the justices. Amongst the justices, service above self. It is bearing one another's burdens. It is caring about one another's burdens. It is getting involved caring about other people's lives. Love, some will sacrifice me to talk among some people. Bearing one another's burdens and what so fulfill the law of Messiah. How can I bear your burden? I must first be aware that you have a burden. What is burdens that we have? Sometimes when we think about bearing one another's burdens, one thing that comes in everybody's mind. What is it?
Money.
Believe you me, that's not your only burden. For some people, it's no burden at all. For some, it's just an occasional burden. Money isn't the main burden. Sometimes people are sad, they are grieved, because they are burdened. They are going through a particular experience in life. It may be a relational experience. It may be an experience on the job. It may be an experience with neighbors. It may be an experience with their health. It may be an experience that they don't even want to talk about. They are confused. Maybe even the devil is on their case,
yes,
and giving them a hard time, and they are truly burdened. They don't know how to carry the load. And sometimes people will cry. Sometimes people go into depression.
Yes.
Sometimes people's face are long. You don't know what the cause is. You don't know what the issue is, but you know something is wrong.
Yes, sir. Yes. My Father.
The Bible says, bearing one another's burden. Now suppose that person who is having a deep burden and somebody who has the capacity, the means, and the way to help that person bear that burden, and they come to the person and they say to that person, listen, and notice that you look out of sorts. You look like you're under a load. Is there anything I can do for you? Can I help you? And the person, in their pride, said, no. I'm okay. I'm fine. And you can see that for weeks, they're under a load. They can't lift it. They can't manage it. And they're praying for help. Help come. But they say, no. Yahweh must send help from heaven.
My Father.
And if you don't come from heaven, you don't want it. But heaven must speak into somebody's heart.
Yes, sir.
And saying, go and fulfill the law of Messiah. And heaven sent you to somebody, and somebody sent you only one direct help from Yahweh.
My Father.
Suppose you have a wolf of it, and you can't manage it. And somebody could give you a little counsel as what to do in some cases. And they come to try and help. And they say, make it look like me not can't manage my family. I'm really not sure you can't manage. You get down on your knees. Yahweh! Yahweh! Send help! Yahweh, touch the heart of the children. Yahweh, do this. Yahweh, do that. And so Yahweh says, okay, I will send help. And somebody who you probably not love more and so.
Yes.
Come.
My Father.
And they want help. They want to help you. And they look up into heaven. But he knows God. And I say, thank you, but just pray for me. Yeah, all right, just pray for me. And you go back on your knees, Yahweh, I need help. What do you think Yahweh is saying? a while Yahweh says you can talk all you want. You can pray all you want. We sit on fire and scare year after year after year, and it's not my fault. And don't matter say I don't answer prayer. Because I'm tired of sending somebody to you. Hallelujah. Bearing one another's burdens. You cannot bear what you are unaware of. Even Torah used to tell us, if you see a man donkey under a load, and the donkey dropped down on his knees and can't get up. And he says, even if you're an enemy, you're supposed to go and take the load off of your enemy's donkey. That he can't stand up. And probably even help, use your donkey and put some of the load on it and help him. That is how you treat your enemy. Much less of a brethren.
My God.
Hallelujah. You know what donkey dropping a ditch? And when help come, I'm all right down here. You know what sitting in a ditch? And when help come, would you like some help down there? I'm getting by, thank you. Big smile all the time, your face is not frowning and you're heavy. When someone big smile just appear out of nowhere, make a white smile to you. No, fine, now everything is okay. How about saying, thank you, Yahweh. Listen, I need some help. I want you to get up here. Listen, come on, pile of dirty clothes in there. I don't have time to wash them. Please, you can help me. A good sister will say, yes, man. So you can take them and wash them for you and give you a break so you can have time to manage your kids so you can get over this little issue that you have. Bearing one another's burden. But I'm afraid that some of us are under burden because we, when I say under a burden, because we've never disclosed that we are under a load. We suffer unnecessarily. And in suffering unnecessarily, we make it look bad upon the church. I know say it's true. You make it look bad upon Yahweh's people like they don't care. And the reason they don't look like they don't care because they don't know. And the reason that they don't know, because nobody will tell them. And sometimes we have to tell them. Don't bother wait for Yahweh to tell them. If you have a load and you can't manage, you don't have to say, wait, Yahweh, talk to somebody. Come to your mouth. You talk to yourself. Go and say to the brother, brother, sister, be hungry. Can't see my way through tonight. Can you help me? And if you don't do that, and you go to bed hungry, good for you. Keep on fasting. Keep on fasting. But don't turn around and say, you mean said nobody could come and give me a little help. You have to go to bed hungry. The children have to go to bed hungry. And look at all them brothers have bread and food to spare. Not one of them could I even get in touch with Yahweh to feel me need. You're not only foolish, now you're murmuring on top of it. Listen. Bearing one another's burdens. We have to seek opportunity to serve.
Yes.
But we not only have to serve, but we have to put ourselves in a place where we know that we are vulnerable, when we are in need of help, when we are in need of not just by ourselves. We need sometimes it's spiritual help. We might need somebody's prayers. Maybe it's not physical things we lack. We have everything that we want physically, but we need spiritual help. Sometimes a word of A word in season, a little counsel, a little advice could make things so much easier for us. Sometimes what is a big problem to us is no problem to somebody else. I remember there used to be a lady on high renting one of the houses many years ago that I used to take care of. She was a teacher at the school. And sometimes a little problem would occur in the house. And she lived on her own. And when you listen to her talk, you know, I think there's some massive problem in her. I mean, I said, you're coming on. All right, bye. Peace. And we used to think, say, poor sister. Poor lady, she was fantastic. That poor lady. And my husband, she needed her. This man will not fix it a long time. But to her, it was such a burden. You could feel as she talked, like some heavy load of words coming to an end. And all sometimes just a simple little adjustment. And sometimes among saints, I just said, sometimes you need a brother, you need a sister. Yahweh will supply the grace. Hallelujah. By this shall all men know. It's not about staying far from others and being deceived with a spirit of superiority, forgetting ourselves. It's about forgetting ourselves, rolling up our sleeves, and getting involved with others. Love isn't about being super spiritual. It's about being immensely practical. There is all this super spiritual love that sometimes we can't relate to. But the practical love, the practical involvement, that we can get related to. Hallelujah. So Yeshua says, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples. We need to then reevaluate the love of which Yeshua speaks. Because it still remains today the yardstick, the gold standard by which our discipleship is measured. I'm closing. Maybe I could read a little bit about the nature of this love in 1 Corinthians 13, 4 to 8. There's a few verses where Saul writes about this love. And all I can say, this kind of love exceeds human limitation. He says, love suffereth long. Whoa. Love suffereth long. Love isn't got a short fuse. It will keep suffering time and time again. Keep enduring. Love is kind. It's one of the qualities of love is kindness. It envieth not. Doesn't want what you have. It's glad that you have it. Some people can't appreciate what people have without envying them for it. You know the difference between jealousy and envy? You don't know the difference between jealousy and envy. Jealousy is when you have something and somebody trying to take it away. It belongs to you in the first place. You'll get jealous, like your wife or something like that. But envy is when you never have it. It didn't belong to you. But somebody else have it. It's not yours. Somebody else's. but you want it. He says, love isn't like that. Love envieth not. So if I don't envy you, what do I do? I see what you have, and I'm happy for you. Some people, somebody get a little promotion, and change their face towards them. If they're speaking to prosper in life, and feel as if it should have happened to me, or whatever you saw. Love doesn't envy. If you make progress. Pastor Gordon gets a brand new car. And they look at me with a little banger.
Yes.
And he said, what? What's up? And me should I have that. Love doesn't envy.
No, sir.
Thank you, Yahweh. Now he can get something good put on the road.
Hallelujah.
Love doesn't look at other people's goods and business. And just wish one of them did have it and it you. No. Love says, thank you, Father, for blessing them.
Hallelujah.
Thank you. Helping them to excel in life. You don't envy other people's children either.
Yes.
Well, you can pick the past common entrance. Pick it up past. Jump. And you've got boof the living. Boof, all your head tops off. Boof. Look how so and so do so. Boof. Look how much money we spend by you. Boof. And sometimes people don't even know why they're doing these things, you know. Because they don't vocalize what they feel. It's in their heart. They're feeling it.
Yes.
You could have done as good as so and so. Make me look like me. Me now spend the money. Make me look like me now do this and me now do that. Just sit down and pick up your book.
Yes.
And making things better, making it worse.
Oh, yeah.
Love envieth not.
Yes.
We rejoice
Hallelujah.
In other success.
Yes.
Not that we don't desire success, but we rejoice in it. Love vaunteth not itself. Vaunting speaks of pride. Put itself forward. Some people, if they don't get a front seat, they're not happy. In everything, self must be seen. That's not love. Love will take a back seat.
Yes.
Love will work behind the scenes where nobody can see you. Love doesn't have to always be in the front of the picture.
No, sir.
It can't stand at the back.
Mercy.
Love vaunteth not itself. That is, make itself prominent. On the contrary, it humbles itself. And would more tend to push others forward. The spirit that is in this world is to push everybody else behind you and you up front. But love works opposite. It it helps others up front. Because you are secure in Yahweh's love. You know, say that no good thing will he withhold from those who walk upright. So you don't have to push yourself. You can take a back seat. Because you know one day we'll call you up. Hallelujah. It's not puffed up. As soon as I puff up, the first thing that comes to my mind is the frog. When a frog feels threatened, what does he do? He inflates. Why does he inflate himself? So he looks more formidable. He's apt to say, back off. Look how big I am. Back off. He says, yeah, love can puff you up. When you're puffed up, it means you are looking bigger than you really are. And sometimes we try to give that impression, don't we?
Oh, yeah.
That we are better than we really are. Mm-hmm. You ever see some people try to pretend that they're richer than they really are?
Yes.
They're trying to pretend that they're richer than they really are.
Yes.
It's like sometimes the boy and the girl, they courted. Mm-hmm. And when they reach a certain community, the girl, otherwise, I said, drop me off here, so. Because you want to look like you're going to a certain big house, or a certain community, but actually, you wait till the car gone. And you go up and dodge, she's on lane. I'm going, I want to get you somewhere. Love is real.
Yes.
We are what we are. We don't have to put on airs. Not puffed up. I don't have to speak better than I can speak. Huh?
My God.
I don't have to pretend I have what I don't have. A friend was telling me about a man, he went into a hotel. Must have somebody paid him to go there. And he loved walk around with that, look like a glass of liquor, but actually wrong water. He can't afford it. But the glass have a cover on it. And he was always walking around with the glass. As soon as that one empty, get it full again. Love is not puffed up. Whenever we feel threatened, we don't have to swell up. We just stay the same.
Yes.
We are what we are. We have no ears. We don't have to put on anything. Some as soon as they broke the coast from Jamaica and touch foreign land and come back. Master P. You know, things that they were born overseas. What happened? You forget Patois? What happened to you? Oh, these roads, oh, these roads are so, oh, these houses are so, oh, do some of you people live in trees? Oh!
My Father.
Love is not puffed up.
No, sir.
We are what we are.
Oh, yeah.
He says, does not behave itself unseemly. That means it has proper behavior all the time. It just does not seek her own. It seeketh for others. It's not easily provoked. It took a whole heap of trouble. A whole heap of problem.
Yes,
to provoke a person that love really loves you.
Yes.
Love doesn't fly off on the handle at the slightest little rebuke, at the slightest little upset. Gone, and for weeks, months before love come back around again. He says love is not easily provoked. It takes a lot for some people to really get angry and upset. Thinketh no evil. In other words, expects the best from people. That's when he says thinketh no evil. He says if there is two scenarios that presents itself concerning a person, love will not think the worst. Mm-hmm. If I see my brother car park in front of a woman's house,
yes.
Love thinketh no evil.
My Father.
Love doesn't put two and two together and say, hmm?
I'm
almost inside every day now. Love thinks it parking car there because he don't want parking car down there because he have to pay money. Then park, it's a free park there, so that's, and he park and walk down when gone. It might not be true, you know.
Yes.
He says, he thinketh no evil. It might be that the man inside of the house there. But he don't think it. And he's anywhere in the house. He runs like that, and that's where he can't park. All right. Love thinketh no evil. We are swift to think the worst.
Yes.
About people.
My Father.
We construct situations in a bad way. And if we ever hear a report about somebody and it is negative, we say, a long time we didn't know. A long time we didn't know. See that? Proof. And if I lie, you hear me now. because sometimes people really like, tell you something. See Jamaican people? They lie and lie and lie and lie and lie.
Mercy.
I can't speak because I'm a Jamaican.
So we know.
So we can't say, they lie.
So we know.
They're deceivers.
Yes. Oh, yes.
And sometimes they know the truth, but just to be mischievous,
yes,
they will tell a lie.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yes.
Or even if they don't tell a lie, they will hint. Hint something bad.
Yes.
Here we go. And when you hear that, now you think the worst, because
yes,
they're not saying anything. So you can't turn around later on and say, then say A, B, and C. But all you hear is, and you think, say, that is wickedness. You're giving the impression of an untruth concerning somebody. You're not speaking the truth, but you know the other person is thinking the worst, and you could speak the truth, and you don't speak it. You are a liar and a wicked person.
Yes.
Because you are a false witness. Without saying a word, you're a false witness. Just by saying, and you know what I'm saying? Hallelujah.
My Father.
Love. Thinking no evil. It thinks the best.
Hallelujah.
Let me see a brother. Let me see with a bottle of Guinness in his hand. First thing we like, jump up. Why is it? What's the alcohol? A secret drinker, yeah? Secret drinker. I wonder how much that they will knock off in a one day. It could be that the man has gone to mix up a little punch,
yes,
mix it with milk in nerves. Eh? But we don't have it. I mean, smell it on him, breath on him. No, sir. Love thinketh no evil.
Bless Yahweh.
That's why, as Yahweh's people, we must reserve judgment. Don't be swift to arrive at conclusion about anything. Swift to hear, slow to speak. Don't agree with anybody, everything you hear. Many times people come to me and make complaint. I'll say, I will check it out.
Yes.
I will check it out. And sometimes we don't even have to check it out. Because we check them out first. And when you check them out, you find out something I need to check out now.
My Father.
Hallelujah.
Bless
Yahweh. Rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in the truth.
Yes, sir.
In other words, love doesn't find any kind of happiness.
Yes.
When bad things happen to people. Even when your enemy, something bad happened to your enemy, we don't laugh. Enemy that's been treating you bad, police come and lock up them boy, or lock them up. You don't rejoice and say, hallelujah, thank you, Father, vindication at last. Prove that they are always your nasty.
Yes.
Love doesn't rejoice in that sort of thing. You find the enemy, broken foot. You visit them in hospital.
Yes.
Isn't that so?
Oh, yes. Sure enough.
They might have treated you in any kind of way. Then you hear a calamity come to them and in the hospital bed. Make it your duty to go see them. Because the Bible says, return good for evil. You heap coals of fire upon their heads.
Yes.
I remember we have a lady on a bottom tongue, man, and she cuss us. One day when she see me in hospital, she start crying. She never expect it?
Yes.
Love does not rejoice iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. We don't rejoice when we hear bad news, but when we hear good news, that makes us happy about people, about others. Yes. It says also, coming down, beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. Love never fails. Hallelujah. You know, there's a simplicity of spirit and a sincerity of spirit amongst Yahweh's people. We're not naive, but neither are we complicated. If my brother whom I trust come and says to me something, give it as facts, I will tend to believe it because he's my brother.
Yes.
I may doubt if it's somebody else. And this is why we need to be careful when dealing with one another.
Yes.
Because each and every one of us have a sacred place of trust in our relationship. I expect to be deceived by the people of this world.
Yes.
I expect for them to pull the wool over my eyes or play it smart. But when I'm dealing with my brother or my sister, I don't expect that kind of treatment. I expect plain, sincere, honest dealing. That's why it is such a disappointment. If you're not sincere. Because as brethren, we have to live and love as brethren. And if we can't believe our brother's word, who shall we believe? So we may doubt what others say. But when it comes to the brethren, we lay weight and value upon their words. That's why we must be plain in our dealing with one another and not use duplicity. Because people are latching on to our words, and in the simplicity of their spirit, they're accepting what is being said at face value. We should speak for face value. Bible says, let your yes be yes. Your no is no. Anything else comes of the wicked one. Love never fails.
Never.
Virgin. When money run out, love is still around.
Oh, yeah.
When friends are gone, love will still be here. When everything that is movable is moved, now abideth, the Bible says. Faith, hope, and love, the greatest of these. Love never fails. When you think about failing, is to think in terms, not about that everything that you do in love must succeed. Not necessarily so. The word failing can also mean like your water from your tank fails because it runs out. The river runs dry. It fails. It's saying love is always there in good supply. What happens when love gets low? Get topped up. Can't get. You see, the Bible says Yahweh is love. Every time we are in connection with Him, whatever we receive of Him must be of love.
Oh, yes.
Even the gifts that He gives us, there must be love that comes with them.
Yes.
That's why we grow in love.
Oh,
the more time we spend with Yahweh, we don't have to keep asking, Yahweh, give me more love, give me more love. With Him is love. Our children learn to love because they learn it from us. You don't have to tell them all the time, you must love, you must love. They see it. They feel it. It affects them. It shapes their thinking and shapes their life. And so it is with Yahweh. In His presence, His word, it shapes us. And it directs us. Hallelujah. Yeshua said so much when He said, new command and guide you that we love one another. We can't exhaust it. Let us stand.